Welcome to CAB Radio 2.0. Here are your hosts, Chris Perkins, Mark Cummins, and Jeff Giles.
It is almost 10 anyway. I told him 9:45 tonight. I figured, you know, we didn't have Jeff on, so we do it a little bit earlier, but it looks like we're coming up on 10 p.m. anyway, so pretty much on schedule. But we'd like to welcome Thomas Gorence to the show. How you doing, man?
Hey, I'm good, man. Thanks for having me back on.
Good to have you back on. It's been a while.
Yeah, it's been a couple months. Yep.
How you been?
Good, man. I've been keeping my head down, working a whole lot. I think the last time that we talked, I had released like the second issue of Time Samplers, and now I'm working on finishing up the fourth issue and starting on the fifth, and I've got like seven other titles on the way out. So I'm really trying to expand the Paranoid American thing, and I've also kind of refocused a little bit. Instead of trying to sell single issues or anything, I'm just going to put all the comics online for free to read, and I'm just going to release like two pages a week for the next year and a half or so. I've got enough content to do it already.
Wow.
So I'm just going to end up making it into like an ongoing kind of free comic series to try to spur up some more interest in some topics that I think are really interesting and important.
That's awesome. Wow. Man, keeping yourself busy then, it sounds. It's got to be a lot of work that goes into that. You have help, though. You have some other guys that help you, right?
Yeah, every time I mention my comics or I show them off, I always get complimented on how great my artwork is, but I don't do any of the artwork. I hire a lot of really good artists, and I hire a lot of really great writers. I'm working right now on a title called Black Mass Pizza, which is basically about I'm not going to give too much away, but it's basically about like a warlock that is sending out possessed delivery pizzas out into to downtown Boston.
Nice.
Specifically into like the Harvard campus. And that's actually being written by a really, really funny guy named Doc Wyatt. And he's actually writing for a lot of TV cartoons like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and Avengers.
Oh, wow.
Spider-Man. He's got a lot of production credits. He's been really established. One of his more popular ones was Napoleon Dynamite. A lot of people have heard of that one.
Oh, okay.
So
well,
like,
Doc Wyatt, that sounds familiar.
Yeah.
The name sounds familiar.
Chris Doc Wyatt. And I'm working with another really, really talented guy named Spencer Laux, and he wrote a comic that I'll be releasing next month called Geronimo's Grave, which is basically a retelling of how Prescott Bush and a couple of the other bonesmen snuck into ancient Indian grounds and basically dug up Geronimo's skull, or so the story goes. And I just kind of bring that story into an illustrated format.
Oh, shit. Right. Yeah, I'm looking him up. Chris Wyatt, right? That is,
yes.
That's his real name? Yep, no kidding. Oh, wow. Yeah, Napoleon Dynamite. No shit. That's awesome. That's awesome, man. Good job.
So I'm hoping to really get a lot of different artists working together with a lot of different writers on topics that I think are a lot more interesting than typical, you know, guys wearing spandex and fighting crime and yada yada. I'm really kind of a agitarian in that sort of regard, because I always liked the anti-hero. I never liked the superhero. I kind of, even as a little kid, I kind of saw him as like this propaganda, you know, representing like this false ideal. And my biggest philosophy behind doing all this comics and everything is I kind of look at like conspiracy theories and corruption and, you know, all these kind of like rumors that go around about how awful the, you know, government is and how like our culture is in general. And I kind of see that as like our modern day mythology. We don't have like Greek gods or anymore. And if, you know, if you don't believe in the same God that's been pushed around for, you know, the last thousands of years and all of his friends, then like the modern gods are kind of like these huge titans and people that command all this respect. Like people think Jay-Z is in the Illuminati and that, you know, David Rockefeller is basically sitting on a golden throne and looking down at the rest of the world, and may or may not be true, who knows. And I think that that's really, really interesting, at least a lot more than, I mean, a lot of people would crucify him, but I think that's way more interesting than Captain America or even maybe the X-Men, you know what I mean?
Right.
Oh, absolutely.
And,
definitely. Yeah,
you've said something
I
to me a couple times. You said something to me a couple times that I hear a lot, actually, and that you don't really read comics a whole lot, but then when you pick this one up, you get through it, and you really enjoy it, and, like, the format kind of works for it. And to be honest,
definitely.
Man, I got to say, like, not even exaggerating, I'd say, like, 90% of the people that I talk to that find this comic, they all say exactly the same thing. They don't read comic books, but this was, you know, I guess it's just the material that's compelling, and I'm glad because that's kind of what I was going for.
Good, yeah, you're doing a good job. Yeah, I didn't. I collected comics, but I didn't read them. I collected them just because they were worth money. I had a big comic book collection, and I had all these awesome comic books, but I didn't read them. I wasn't into this stuff, but I collected sports cards and comics. You know, I just like collecting.
Yeah, I can see. I mean, I was like that on the sports front. Like, I would collect all kinds of sports cards, but I didn't really care about the sport in itself. I just kind of knew, like, oh shit, Jose Canseco cards are worth a lot.
Yeah,
maybe
he's
my favorite player, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I maybe saw him in like a couple games and didn't really care.
No, absolutely right. You put a spin on comics that makes me want to makes me want to read them, absolutely.
And you know, you mentioned like probably one of the biggest influences I can even think of, since I can remember back when I started wanting to kind of have some creative pursuits. And at the beginning of the show, you mentioned Terrence McKenna. And I actually, like, always go – I watch his videos all the time. And there's this one in particular that's, like, my favorite. And he's talking about how culture is not your friend. You can probably just look it up on YouTube, culture is not your friend. And he kind of explains how everyone likes to bond to this culture and feel like they're part of this kind of, like, clique and this group and be identified. But really – the culture is your absolute enemy. It's there for, like, convenience of institutions and for, you know, someone to put into a pamphlet and advertising and for someone to look through their demographics materials, and that's kind of what culture is. And someone – it was in this this crowd that he was giving, like, a live talk to, and someone asked him, you know, how do you fight back against all this? And I kind of took that as meaning, like, how do you fight back against, you know, corruption and conspiracies and everything that you guys talk about and get angry about? How do you actually go – against that? And at least in this guy's opinion, Terrence McKenna, who I hold in really high regard, he said that the only real way to fight back is to create art, period. And he didn't kind of like try to expand on that at all, and that has really been one of the biggest driving forces. So it was really cool that you mentioned them at the beginning of this episode.
Yeah, Mark didn't even know who he was. Which surprised me. That definitely surprised
me. You need
to
get on Google, Mark.
Yeah,
you do,
no,
you
absolutely.
Do.
I'm gonna look him up.
You really should.
We talked about him a show or two ago, and the only reason is because somebody linked him to Timothy Leary, and that's the only reason I even had any idea.
Funny you mentioned Timothy Leary. There's actually a comic that is coming out soon that kind of mentions him in a side regard, but. I'm going to detract for 1 second because we were talking about psychedelic medicine and everything. And if either of you guys heard of Salvia divinorum?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Oh, yes.
So one of, I mean, this stuff got really popular when people were posting, you know, videos on YouTube and jumping out of windows and acting like idiots and everything.
Yeah.
Before that, it was like virtually unknown. It was basically sold as incense in a lot of just head shops. They didn't even know what they were selling. It was just kind of was there for people that knew what it was. And going way back, the guy that even brought that to the entire Western world and magic mushrooms, both salvia divinorum and mushrooms, was this guy named Robert Gordon Wasson. And he was basically the inspiration for Timothy Leary. Without him, there would be no Timothy Leary. He was a huge hobnob on Wall Street. He worked for J.P. Morgan. And he actually... he was in part of the Century Club, and he was friends with Henry Luce of Time Magazine. And the really weird thing is that he was doing all these weird travels out into, like, Mexico and speaking with shaman, and he'd bring back all their different drugs. And for some reason, he was able to get this feature in Time magazine on the magic mushroom. And this was, like, way before drugs were even really accepted at all. Like, it was completely unheard of, basically. And this kind of article, Timothy Leary had always cited as his main inspiration to even getting into the entire psychedelic movement, you know. Some people say that he even kind of sparked it. And I always thought it was interesting that this Watson guy was behind it all. And he wasn't like a psychonaut or anything. He was a banker. He was a researcher. And I got a comic coming out that kind of explains a little bit more into his backstory.
No kidding.
That's pretty cool.
That definitely interests me right there.
I mean, think about it. And J.P. Morgan had a huge collection of like mushroom artifacts, like old ancient stone mushrooms and mushroom paintings. And I tried looking a little bit more into that. I haven't been able to uncover a whole lot more detail on it, but I find it incredibly fascinating. So I'm definitely going to try to dig a little deeper.
Yeah, I'm going to have to now. I'm writing that down.
Yeah, I'm really, that is incredibly fascinating.
They're written down so I don't forget, because I might end up forgetting.
Too many of these people got, pushed away from the mainstream. They just, you know, were looked at as outlaws, crazy people, super, super intelligent people.
So I think that's a side effect of, you know, all the research money that goes into drugs goes into showing how harmful they are and showing how bad they are.
Yep.
And there's absolutely no research showing how good they are. And when you ask, you know, why not, they say, well, there's no research that says that it's good. So, and we've got all this research that says that it's bad. So take the drugs that we've manufactured.
Yeah,
screw that one
that
you can grow for free. You know, here's the one that you need.
Psychedelics, they're not a neurotoxic. They're, if people don't know what a neurotoxin is, it's poisonous complex, mostly a protein that acts on the nervous system. But anyway, that's not what they are. I know a lot of people actually think that that's what they do. You're not even hallucinating. That's how I look at it. Like, when you do it, you're not hallucinating. You're mostly, you're seeing things, you know, how they really are. Kind of hard to explain. But
explaining it to someone that's never actually experienced it. It's one of those mind-boggling experiences.
Yeah.
I've heard that theory before. Because I do know exactly what you mean. I don't know. I do know that, you know, they can be useful, you know, mind opening, if you will. We've talked about it on this show, Thomas, and what you were just briefly were getting into. We've talked about it a bunch. That, you know, the drugs that they want us to take, you know, they want us to take them for a reason. They don't want us to, you know, even right down to pot, just right down to marijuana. You know, they don't want us to consume that.
The two most dangerous drugs anyway are alcohol and nicotine, and they're both legal.
Well, I mean, it's really not about health or what's good for you or anything. I mean, it's kind of ridiculous how that even becomes part of the argument. it's really hard to frame it into a really good argument to convince anyone otherwise, but there's a really great stand-up routine by Bill Hicks. And if you know Bill Hicks, he kind of jumps in between jokes and then into kind of like lectures. And there's a bit where he kind of explains that, you know, the drugs that are legal are the ones that kind of calm you down or have you kind of stop thinking. And the drugs
get
really
dull
creative
you
and really spark your imagination and make you want to think, you know, brand new things, those are the ones that are, you know, the scariest to them, absolute scariest.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that seems to be one of the main coincidences among all the different ones that seem to be hawked as, like, you know, they're going to kill you. You ever touch DMT and once in your life with your pinky, you know, you're going to think you're an orange and peel yourself.
Right.
And you'll die, you know.
Right, right. Absolutely.
I mean, and not to mention that the same drugs they're saying are going to do this, they were, like, spraying into the public and testing it in public and putting it in water supplies and, you know.
Well, half the drugs that were coming out, especially, let's say, back in the late 50s, early 60s, were given to soldiers. You know, they were experimented on the army to begin with.
Yeah, man, we got a whole timeline. It goes from Project Shatter to Project Bluebird to a whole bunch of like it's just a long sequence of where I think one of the original stories, they went over to the concentration camps and they saw that they were using mescaline as a way to as like a truth serum, and they brought that back and they started using it on Navy recruits. This is actually, to lead it back again, there's a comic you can read right now on the website for free called Operation Midnight Climax. It kind of recounts sort of a history of this, and it talks about all the main players and who kind of, like what the project names were, who the generals were that were involved. I try to get, you know, all the real details in there.
Nice. And plug that again. What was it? Can you see the name again?
It's called, it's on ParanoidAmerican.com, and it's called Operation Midnight Climax. It's part of an ongoing series of short stories called Paranoid American History, where each one is kind of like a anti-propaganda piece. So instead of having this, you know, our great leader comic, it's like, well, here's what, you know, Prescott, here's what the Grandpa Bush was doing back in the day.
Right. Good. So, no, and, you know, as I think, as we were talking about earlier, me and Chris were talking about earlier, that, you know, it's good that people are bringing this to, you know, to the limelight, to the mainstream again, and the benefits of these drugs, that, you know, true benefits that they can have, you know, physically, emotionally, mentally, you know, spiritually, on all different levels. I say it all the time. I credit drugs. I used to be heavy, you know, into LSD and psilocybin mushrooms, and you know, it's been a few years because I feel like I kind of grew out of that point, or you know what I mean, past that or whatnot. But like, I think I would have been a complete ignorant redneck if it hadn't been for, you know, honestly, for experimenting in drug use, because it was just the way that I was brought up. You know, I was brought up
I think that's a side effect of it kind of being put into this, like, outcast sort of light, and if you're found out, then you're not going to have a regular job, and you're going to get kicked out of school, and you're going to get kicked out of any sort of, you know, government position, any kind of benefits you might have going on, all just gets ripped out from under you. So then you're either hanging out with other people that are in the same situation as you, or, you know, you're kind of relegated to the corner, and it's real easy to be like, oh, point your finger and look at those guys in the corner. You don't want to end up like that, and that's what drugs do. And it's like, I'm sure you've seen the picture going around with the cop where it's like, drugs will ruin your life, so if I catch you with them, I'll ruin your life. You know what I mean? That's it exactly, I think. I don't think anyone should be prevented from doing them. No one should be prevented from doing a drug that they either need to do or want to do. No one should ever have to be forced to do a drug. You know what I mean? But it's ridiculous. Like, you've got drinking competitions, but then you can't legalize drugs that have legitimate medical uses and therapeutic uses with, you know, clinical trials. Show me one single clinical trial that says drinking, you know, two pitchers of beer has some sort of, like, medicinal quality to it. So,
correct.
And I think the old argument, too, was that if it was shown to kill brain cells in any capacity whatsoever, then it was going to be like a Schedule I drug, or it was going to be made illegal. But you can't tell me that, you know, you don't lose any brain cells down in two pints of beer in one night, or even getting, like, you know, real shit faced. So,
of course.
And it's actually studies that say it regenerates your brain cells.
Psilocybin, correct?
Yes. And reduces anxiety in terminal cancer patients. Even MDMA, I mean, you can treat PTSD with it. There's some numbers on it. There's an 83% cure rate. MDMA, I have it written down here. Anyway,
well,
yes.
Well, it absolutely started as a therapeutic drug for couples or something.
Yeah.
And then it turned into like a Texas nightclub drug for a little while.
Right.
And then, you know, they got crazy and banned it. Like, they basically announced it on the news, hey, this drug is now illegal. If you've got any, you know, it's basically like, do it now or forever hold your peace.
Yep. Oh, Jeff is calling in.
Hey, guys.
Hey, Jeff.
Awesome conversation. Sorry I couldn't join so far. I'm kind of inhaling flea destruction. We had a flea outbreak, so I had to spray the house, and right now I only got to do my room so far, but right now I'm sitting in my room and inhaling these fumes, and it's disgusting, but whatever.
Drugs of all kinds.
Oh, yeah, right?
Yeah.
It's just wonderful. But you guys are spot on about what you're saying, and I definitely have a feeling it makes people smarter when they experiment with these drugs, especially like magic mushrooms and maybe even LSD. I'm going to go with LSD as well.
Oh, yeah,
MDMA.
For sure. MDMA, DMT, peyote,
they definitely
ayahuasca.
even David Icke encourages use of psychedelics to expand the mind and expand your intelligence.
Aleister Crowley did too.
I'm not gonna
do a psychedelic. It doesn't matter who else like has done it. Like before you do it, or when you're trying to explain to other people, it's like, oh well, you know, Oprah smoked once, or if you told him that, you know, Donald Rumsfeld himself took LSD at one point and now he's totally fine, debatably, then like all of a sudden people would be like, oh yeah, maybe try that. But then once you actually do it, so I hear, then like everyone else's kind of subjective experience, it's kind of completely irrelevant, because what it does is it opens your eyes up to what it's like to not have your own ego just kind of standing in the way and blocking your view. And hearing someone else's story about, you know, how they did that, it's funny because it has, like, no bearing at all on the experience and what we're really talking about the potential behind it.
Absolutely. And everybody's experience is always different. When you talk to, you know, somebody about their experience or you share experiences, you have that, like, way to relate on it, you know. Like, you can always relate to that experience, even if, you know, it's not an identical experience.
It's interesting that you brought up salvia, because that was the one time I had a bad experience. I didn't research the drug too well.
We talked about this, right?
I know we did, and I didn't research.
On a show, yeah.
I'm sure, and I didn't look into it that well. I didn't take it seriously because it was being sold. I think I bought it off of eBay. I didn't think it'd be that serious.
Yeah, I mean, it used to be that easy to get because no one knew what it was. It was incense, basically.
Right, and I bought. I went straight to the strongest kind I could find at the time.
Yeah,
which
like 40x or something.
I did 55x.
Oh, shit.
And I didn't...
They call it, like, horse killer or something like that.
Oh, man. Well, I almost died because I went my room. I was smart enough to, like, get the cats out and everything so I wouldn't accidentally kill them for whatever reason. I didn't think it... So I shut the door, I went on my bed, and I took one hit, and I was like, okay, well, this isn't doing anything. And then, like, 2 seconds later, it, like, fell out of my hand, and I literally fell on the floor and, like, started, like, moving around.
Yep.
And, like, what seemed to be, like, days after, and surprisingly, it was only, like, 5 or 10 minutes later, when I finally came to it, I noticed that I was physically in between the bureau. And this is, like a 5-foot-tall bureau, and, like, I pushed it off against the wall somehow, and my head was in between it, like that and the wall. And I noticed when I, you know, when I finally got up, and like, I was so thankful that, like, I came back to reality, because it was, like, hell, dude. It was a bad trip out the ass. It was... probably the scariest moment of my life. I don't even want
to,
like...
You can talk to, like, psychonauts and hardcore drug users of all ages, you know, like old-school heroin junkies that have been through, like, Woodstock, you know, a million times over, and a lot of them will say that same thing, that, like, salvia is, like, the real deal. It'll knock your socks off, and it usually terrifies people to the point where they look at it, and they're like, I never want to see that again.
Dude, because I felt like I was being erased from, I felt like I was completely erased from reality. I forgot who I was. I couldn't, like, during that moment, I didn't know who I was, anything about my life, my name. All I knew is I wanted to exist again. And I felt like, I was, like, in a complete illusion, and, like, everything was just fake, and, like, reality was fake.
Was it, like, clay animation? I did it once, and shit turned to, like, clay animation, and it... And I was like, I couldn't tell, but like I started drooling when I started talking, because I knew I had to leave in a little while, and I was like, is this gonna wear off? Because obviously I could never fucking drive a car on this. And
that's you know, one of the good reasons that people probably shouldn't be doing them and driving cars or anything.
Oh yeah, no.
But I really think it's one of the best psychedelics out. It's actually the strongest psychedelic in nature, apparently. The medical compound Sovereign A is the most potent out of anything we've ever found by, like, orders of magnitude. And they still have no idea how it really works. All they know is it kind of activates the same portion of the brain that kind of activates when you're dreaming. So it kind of, like, is able to sort of trigger some sort of, like, a daydreaming state of some kind. But I think it's really fascinating because it's like this self-regulating drug. You know, like, you couldn't overdo it because it would terrify the hell out of you. But at the same time, it has this inverse tolerance property where instead of the more you do over time, you build up this tolerance. It's actually like you get more and more used to it. And I've read a lot of books that the guys have trying to kind of explain the chemistry and the psychology behind it. But it sounds like what you're really doing is you kind of just, like, jumped right into the deep end of the pool, you know, the 55-foot deep end, and sank right to the bottom, and you weren't even ready for it. You didn't even hold your breath before
you jumped
in, you know? A lot of people are kind of confronted with it at, like, a party or in, like, a party setting, or there's people around. It's absolutely not the way to do it at all, you know what I mean?
It'll I wouldn't think so.
It'll be like, you know, giving you a bunch of MDMA and then leaving you at Burning Man and be like, enjoy, you know? Like, no water or anything, you know?
Man. Well, dude, I mean, I thought, like, at that moment, like, since I couldn't remember anything about reality, all I knew was that, like, aliens, like, killed the planet and killed all of us. That's what I thought. Like, I thought, like, aliens were watching me at that moment, and, like, I completely, like, felt like I could sense their presence or whatever. And when I finally came to it, I, like, reached for the doorknob, and eventually when I got back on my feet, I looked in the mirror, and I had a black eye, and my ankle was, it felt like my ankle was broken. It ended up, like, being
sprained. You need what they call a sitter, man. Someone there to just tell you to keep sitting.
Died, dude. I could have fucking died from that. And
I mean, people are getting very, very hurt doing it because it's unlike any other drug where it kind of has, like, a slow come up, or you kind of like, oh, I think I might feel weird a little bit, and then 5 minutes later it's there.
I mean, with
salvia, literally, every single person on their first try, you know, they take, like, a big hit or two, and they're like, oh, that's it? I don't think I feel anything. And then they immediately forget the English language, and they immediately start sweating really bad and drooling, and, you know, and what it is it's an instant loss of ego. It goes from 0 to 60 in, like, 0.00001 seconds, and if you don't even know that that's coming, it's going to be the most terrifying experience of your life, because it really does feel like the entire world's just been ripped away from you, because it kind of has, you know?
But
if you know that going into it, and if you kind of plan for that, and you have a reason to feel that way, then I think it could be incredibly therapeutic use, and that's one of the lesser known ones, because it kind of got laughed off as, like, you know, that drug that teenagers were ordering online and, you know, getting fucked up on.
Right, making your brain dead.
Well, dude,
this is, like, the new shit.
I freaked out for, like, it just messed with me for weeks, dude. I just, because after, you know, when I was looking in the mirror or whatever, I just looked at myself and I just thought to myself, I'm not even real. I don't even really exist.
I would argue that that's not even the drug that's doing that. That was just the experience that was having all those after effects.
It wasn't the drug, dude. That was the experience from the drug. Because I remembered the experience from the drug, and it fucking terrified me. And I freaked out. I told a couple friends, and, like, I was just, like, depressed for a couple weeks afterwards. And, like, I go outside, and I look out, you know, it just all, at that point, just seemed like a huge hologram that we're just living in at that point. It was creepy as hell.
Well, you're kind of right, I'd assume.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think that's the same reason why it's so helpful, because you could take someone that feels like they're so boxed in, or, you know, or they've got other issues that are just mentally blocking them from doing the things that they should be able to do, you know what I mean? And if that can just kind of crack that door open a little bit and, you know, let some fresh air in, then...
It makes you value life, for sure, and makes you want to get some shit done. That's probably...
for better or for worse, you'll value life more.
That was actually right before I started doing stuff, so that probably kicked my ass and made me do stuff like activism, and because it just made me realize how valuable life is and how, you know, how we can't take it for granted, and we're only going to be alive for so much time. And
you know, I think the Salvi experience was a huge factor in that.
Oh, yeah. I completely... Well, of course it was. Well, it had to be. And it freaked me out.
I mean, I would still chalk that down as, you know, one good one for Salvia. It scared the shit out of you in a good way, then.
It beat me up is what it did. It did. It wasn't the same type of experience as LSD. I mean, I tripped, you know, my face off with LSD, and I loved that, man. That was just great.
Well, that's a very social experience, right. And Salvia is not. That. Salvia is you are one-on-one with your maker, essentially.
Oh, man, and that was terrifying.
There must be something with my chemical makeup. I've done it twice. And in the first time that I did it, the gentleman explained it to me just exactly how you guys explained it. You're going to just lose, you know, it's going to be like life, you know, changing retrospect of everything. And
some
I tried
hard heads. You might be a hard head.
It was like crack for me. I hit it, and all I wanted to do was more. I was just like, wow, I want to hit that again.
Really?
Mark, what strength did you do? What strength did you do? Because I did 50 times, 55.
Yeah, I can't tell you. It looked like black.
It was an extract for sure, though. If it was black, it was an extract, because the regular leaves or even like the 5 to 10x are still green.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mark, I encourage you to do the stronger shit.
Man, I don't know.
There's some people called hardheads, and there's kind of like different levels. There's a great book. I think it's just called Salvia Divinorum on Amazon. You can find. It's got like a picture of the flower on it. But this guy kind of he mentions how there's been no official clinical studies that kind of document the process and the experience. So he kind of took it out on himself, and he kind of outlines these different phases. And you can go on like a Rowit, I think is one of the more popular sites. Where people do like the trip reports, and it's extremely consistent, like back to back. And there's like this first level where you get real giddy and you laugh and you sweat and you drool, and it's real kind of funny and disorienting. And it maybe lasts like 15 minutes or something like that. And some people just get that every time, and they just giggle, and it's almost like an amphetamine sort of an effect. But then you can do something called breaking through, and that's kind of like a step after that, and that's that ego loss. And apparently some people have a real hard time getting there, but apparently if you get to that first stage, you can get to the second one. But I wouldn't suggest it for everybody. It's not something you want to, like, work at unless, you know, you know what you're trying to do.
Right. And I would say if you're going to do it, seriously, you have to have a sitter, like he says. You really do have to have one, otherwise you can get hurt.
I think it's still legal in like maybe 20 states left, maybe less than that, like 15 states or something.
Okay. Ooh. Well, I would also suggest you go to YouTube and do a search for Salvia bad trip, and you can see what I'm talking about, dude. All those bad trips that you see on the YouTube videos, that's exactly what happens, man. And that's
I can explain that bad process and kind of the thought process behind it, because I've seen it happen to a lot of people. And what usually happens is you lose your ego, and the first thing you want to do is you want to prove to yourself that you do exist and that you do have a body and that you do have control over your body. So you do something stupid like stand up and like move your arm around, but you don't realize that, you know, you don't have control over all this, and you're just kind of fighting an uphill battle that you're not going to win, and it's kind of just like, you know, thrashing around in sort of quicksand. To an effect, but that quicksand might end up being like that glass living room table in front of you.
Right. And when
ego, but that's the danger.
When it gets rid of your ego, we're not talking about like, you know, being stuck up or, you know.
Like the fact that you know that you're a human being that exists in a universe where other people exist. It just, that's ripped out completely from under you. And, you know, the explanation stops there. I'm not even going to try to get further than that.
It's impossible. It's like I literally felt like I became like a piece of the furniture. Like I just melted. It was scary as hell, man. Yeah, like I didn't think I existed. I knew at one point in my life I did exist, but what terrified me the most was I couldn't remember anything and I couldn't even remember who the fuck I was. It was just so it was hell, man.
That's what's so interesting, man, is that it's not subjective like all the other things that you guys have been talking about. This one is very, very objective in the way that people react to it and the way that it makes you feel and things that you see like melting into furniture. Like that's usually the number one reason why someone wants to stand up, to prove that I need to prove to myself right now that I'm not really part of this chair. And the only way I can do that is stand up.
I was trying to stand up, dude. I couldn't, though. I was, like, obviously falling out on the floor, and, like, I was just on the floor the whole time. I was trying to get up, though, believe me. But, yeah, the first thing that I did when I did come to it was I wanted to see another life, and I, like, saw my cats, and they just made me feel like even my cats, I thought at that point as I was coming out of it that they are fake. They aren't real. It's all an illusion. And, like, then, you know, I just went in the other room and just laid on the ground in front of the TV and just, like, laid there, like, looking up. And it was so creepy. And I think it was during the time of that huge tsunami that killed, like, almost 1 million people or whatever. On the coast of, I forget where it was, India and all. Yeah,
India.
That was years ago. Wow.
You're probably being real receptive to anything like that, any kind of traumatic experience, especially on a global level.
Yeah.
And well, I kind of think that's what all the psychedelics do, and that's what any major life event or anything that happens to you, it's a trauma. It might be a good one or a bad one, but it's a traumatic event that happens, and these are ones that you can, like, spur within, like, your own, you know, controlled environment, so to speak. Like, this is a traumatic experience that you can decide to go through. And, you know, it's not like something that's going to catch you off guard, even though it definitely is. I'm not talking about salvia in general. I'm talking about psychedelics and...
Dude, I have some cool LSD stories, man.
Oh, yeah. I tripped one night into the morning and woke up. Well, didn't wake up. I was still up to 9/11. So I was I was coming down off it or whatever, but I was all... Still, yeah, dude, so we didn't...
Did you actually believe it?
Well...
right?
That's awful, man.
The only reason why we did is because someone that was with us, his mom called us, or called him, to let him know what was going on, so then we turned the TV on. So we kind of... So it was pretty traumatic. It really...
Brutal.
It definitely messed with my head.
Yeah. I can't even imagine something like that guy. I watched a guy die in front of me once during a peak. Oh, what? I can't imagine.
Damn. What, at a festival or something? Yeah.
I know. It was actually the downtown Oldport. He fell out of a window. Kafunk. Oh, I'll never forget the sound.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it was the sound that still
Oldport,
haunts me.
What the hell was the drug was he on?
Portland?
I believe, drinking. This is a story. I'm across we're probably 5, 6, 7 stories up in these apartments, and across the street down in the old port in Portland, Maine, in the city there, there's, he's across the street at an equal level, you know, 6, 7 stories up. And they have a door that opens up into the street. It opens up into, like, nothing. No balcony, no anything. Okay, and they're having a party over across the street, and they're, you know, we're hooting and hollering is what we're doing. We're yelling back and forth across the street. Like I said, they're drinking heavily. We're doing, you know, major drugs. And one of the guys was, like, you know, hanging his leg out the door or whatnot and just, you know, goofing off. You could tell he had a drink in his hand, and he slipped. He slipped and he fell, and I was sitting at the other window, you know, watching him, and just kabunk, just, you know, hit the pavement, done. And I left the window. I probably left the party, if I remember right. I don't know. I know that it really affected me very badly.
Yeah, it's kind of a buzzkill.
Yeah, it certainly was.
Wow.
Certainly was.
You guys see me to sitter for all kinds of drugs.
No, we used to, you mentioned the word sitter for salvia. We used to use sitters for LSD because, again, we used to just do so much, try to,
Yeah,
you know,
I mean, you had to
experiment
prevent
with it.
From peeling themselves like oranges, right?
Right. Oh, absolutely. I've had friends talk to aliens, and we used to do experiments and stuff, and you know, like deprivation tanks and
oh, nice.
We started doing things like that at 14, 15. From around 14 to 15 until around 19,
wow.
I did acid at least monthly,
nice.
if not weekly.
Right.
I tried to do it weekly, every week, as long as I could get it.
Dude, I had a weird experience with like five other people in Valley Forge, and I was just like, I took a couple hits of acid, and the shit I was seeing was out of this world, and we went under that huge Masonic arc that they have there, and they have a lot of weird Masonic stuff there. They have an obelisk and an arc, and it says, you know, dedicated to the Masons and all that stuff. And after I passed through the arc, I just felt creepy, and then we went and laid down in the grass, and when I was looking up, I could have sworn I was seeing, like, all sorts of weird, dude, I swear it was, like, witchcraft-type stuff going on, dude, in the sky, and, like, like, holographic, like, and, like, an alien looking down and shit. It was creepy. That whole day was, but it was, the whole day was still awesome, I mean, because it was a beautiful day out, and I was with a lot of good people that I liked.
Right.
And, wow, I mean, it was crazy, though.
You mentioned the deprivation tanks.
Yeah.
You know, one of the pioneers of that, the whole thing, deprivation tank, John Lilly, I think. He was a guy that worked with the dolphins and everything. And he actually said that once you get good enough at using a deprivation tank, it mimics the exact effects of, you know, any kind of psychedelic you could think of.
Right.
And that he himself would get into, like, the worst trip you could imagine just from floating in salt water. He didn't take any drugs or anything at that point. And he was able to go in there and consciously go into it. He couldn't decide what, like, how hard he wanted to trip. He didn't have that kind of control. And he actually developed this whole sort of fluctuating system where, like, it ranged from, like, -3 to -6 or something. So if he went and he had a 3 trip, that was, like, a good mild one. And if he had a -6 trip, it was, like, the harshest, you know, thought that Satan was, like, devouring him or something kind of a trip.
Now there was a book written. There was a book written very similar to this. I want to say it was probably in the 70s, maybe the 80s.
You probably wrote it, man. It was like Cyclone of the Mind or something like that.
Well, in the book, the guy, and I believe it was actually made into a movie, but the guy ends up going crazy because of the continuous use of the tank.
Oh, Altered Minds is the movie.
Altered States.
That
right.
Altered States, and that's actually based on John C. Lilly's work. That was completely based on his work. Yeah.
Okay. What a great book! Wow, I hadn't thought about that book in years. I believe it's made
it
to a movie.
That was actually a test done for the Navy that was probably a follow-up to Project Chatter and, you know, all of those other drug trials that we were talking about way before. That was sort of another funded project in that long series.
So, what do you think the explanation is of that? How does that happen? I mean, if you're not actually on drugs, if all you have is silence, so you're saying complete silence is going to...
It's not just silence. I mean,
it
evolved over time. So first he started by just kind of floating in water, and then he started floating in water in the dark, and then he started floating in water that was like body temperature, and each of these little things that he tweaked, it would get more and more intense. And then he found out that if he used salt water, that he would actually be able to sink just below the surface so that he could breathe, but that he wouldn't feel the air touching his skin from, like, coming up against the surface and back down again. So if he had just the right salinity in the water and all these different variables, and he had this thing down to an exact science where he kind of just dial it in and go in there and go crazy if he wanted to.
So what is that? I mean, how come that? I mean, still, why does that happen if it's just salt water and silence and also, like, I don't know.
In my experience personally, it takes time. You know, you don't just sit in some sort of secluded device or something for just, you know, 5-10 minutes and you're going to have this weird, you know, experience. But if you do it for 9 hours of nothing, you know, you're gonna think no sound, no light, I mean none, not like, you know, but zero. And, you know, like, again, 9-10 hour period, it can kind of be like, it can do pretty crazy things. You can start, you know, you start using your mind in ways that you normally wouldn't with outer, influences. Does that make sense?
Yeah, you're essentially cutting off your eyes and your ears and your nose and your feeling of touch, so that you have zero extrasensory sort of perception coming in. You have no input. All you kind of have is what's in your mind, and your mind can't really handle this because it's so used to getting color and sound and things
exactly.
to kind of to process. And now it just has to sit in its own sort of muck and make something out of that. And it needs to stay busy, otherwise it goes crazy.
Is the absorption of salt a factor? And what happens if you have a bad trip in this? Aren't you at risk of drowning?
I'm pretty sure he had, you know, like a sitter, and he was completely
again, yeah.
Because, I mean, this
right.
is all funded by the government and through
right,
college and
right.
everything. The salt was just a factor in the buoyancy of the body in the water.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause he noticed that if he was by the surface, every time he hit the surface and it broke and he felt the air in his chest, it would kind of take him out of it a little bit. And his
right.
goal was to just make it so that he was absolutely isolated and had no distractions whatsoever.
Thomas, am I mistaken? It's been, 15 years since I've read this book. Am I mistaken by thinking that at the beginning he used mind-altering drugs with the deprivation tank, right?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And then,
at the end,
he stopped using them completely.
Right, exactly.
Yep.
Yes, what a great book. I can't believe it's been so many years.
I believe it's called Cyclone of the Mind. I think that's
okay.
what it's called.
Yep. Excellent book. Really good. I suggest anybody to read it. And
I
so,
think that
what
work she does on documenting it is amazing.
Yes. What got me into that was that book. Was we took that and we said, hey, let's do that. You know, with things from Timothy Leary and from that book and, you know, other just sources. And we just put shit together and tried different experiments and stuff, and we had a
you
lot
know what's
of fun
crazy
with
is
it.
That, man, like, at one point, this was the most top secret and groundbreaking and, like, cutting-edge technology that they'd ever really kind of pursued outside of, like, atomic weaponry. Like, this
mm-hmm.
was, no one had done this kind of stuff before with the psychedelic drugs and deprivation tanks, and this was a completely new area to everyone, and, you know, the government was terrified of that because they wanted to kind of be the first to know what it all did and how to control it and
right.
whatnot.
So what if you combined it, like LSD with the sleep or the, not sleep the tank?
Yeah, the isolation tank?
Right.
I think he started out doing little doses, and then he found out that he didn't need to. And he also did a lot of work with, he would, back when he was doing a lot of LSD, he would take LSD and then, like, swim with dolphins and hang out with them for, you know, weeks and weeks on end, and he would document, like, all of his thoughts on doing, like, telekinetic work with them, and it was really, really interesting. He was kind of a huge proponent of, like, Save the Dolphins and,
right.
you know, kind of, like, before it was kind of cool and you could put a bumper sticker on the back of your car, he was kind of doing it. And it was because he had developed this, what he thought was a really, really strong sort of emotional connection to him.
Wow. I still have yet to swim with dolphins, so someday. I haven't gone skydiving either.
I won't.
No, are you serious? I would.
Nah. Not for me.
I definitely want to go. I'll go with you, Jeff.
Nice. All right.
I'll be waiting on the ground for you guys.
we'll pack each other's shoots. We'll be like Point Break. Go rob a bank.
What?
Whatever, dude. Point Break. Don't tell me you haven't seen that.
Oh, I know what Point Break is. I know.
You guys are silly.
Yes, we are.
I don't know why it makes me
shoot shit about, like, the music industry here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Perfect.
We'll go to break and we'll come back. And,
all right, I'm gonna get back to doing this stuff, dude. I gotta get this shit done.
Go have some more drugs.
It reeks in here. Yeah. It's basically it.
Get a sitter.
That's hilarious.
All right, guys. I'll talk to you in a little bit.
All right.
All right, man.
All right.
Peace.
Peace.
Oh, that guy, I tell you, that guy.
That guy. Jeff.
He's swearing. He's swearing right now. Because he's still listening. All right, so we'll go to break. We'll be back, everybody.
The Joe Rogan Experience.
And I can't thank you enough, Joe, for really sticking your neck out there and really, I know you faced a lot of criticism for your support of psychedelics.
Not really. No, it's been pretty easy. I'm going to be honest with you.
Okay. I'm sitting here giving this, like, heartfelt
no,
speech.
No, you don't have to.
No, but I just
nobody
appreciate
takes me
you.
Seriously. It's a great way to, it's a great position to be in.
But I did take you seriously that day in the podcast when you told me mushrooms could change the world, and it really planted a seed in my head, which sprouted this journey that I've been doing around the world investigating these medicines. And that never would have happened. My, you know, my life wouldn't be in such the amazing state I feel like it is in now if it hadn't been for you having the gumption to talk about this and start this dialogue as our country, because psychedelics have been so taboo, especially in the mainstream, and I think you're really helping to shift that consciousness nationwide.
I honestly don't think I am. I think I'm just a part of the whole thing itself. I mean,
yeah.
It's very nice to try to give me, so I don't deserve any credit, nor do I want any. I'm shocked that more people don't know about the experiences, and I feel a duty because I've been there. It's just like if you and your friends were starving to death and you found some food in the desert and you're like, guys, come here, I found the food. Would you want all this credit for finding that food? No, you'd want your friends to have the food. That's how I feel. I feel like, you know, what we're all experiencing right now is a wait, what moment.
Mm-hmm.
The whole culture is going, wait. The NSA is listening to my fucking emails. They're listening to my voicemails. They're reading my emails. I don't do anything wrong, man. Come on, I'm a fucking insurance salesman. And then people go, wait. What? Marijuana makes how much in fucking taxes for Colorado? They make how much for? We're running out of fucking money for schools, and we could pay for that with weed. But and people are gonna smoke the same amount of weed anyway, statistically proven. What the fuck is going on? When you look at, wait, what? We're going to go into Syria? Wait, whoa. What the fuck are we doing? This wait, what moment is we're all a part of this wait, what moment. You're a big part of this wait, what moment.
Yes.
You're a big part of it by sticking your neck out about Bahrain and about CNN and about, you know, working for a corporation and being honest about it. You stuck your neck out about it. We're all forced into this reality. We didn't ask to be here. We weren't, you know, hey, could you give birth to me so I can grow up in the 21st century? And no, this is what you get. Nobody asked you. This is what you get. And I think all of us realize that was the same for our parents. It was the same for our grandparents. It was the same for everybody. And nobody hit the brakes. Nobody had the wait what moment where they went, wait, what the fuck are we doing? Everybody just kept going and then had heart attacks and died. And taught a bunch of nonsense to their kids. And they went, and they had heart attacks and died, teaching a bunch of nonsense to their kids. And then the internet came along. And that's the wait-what moment. And the wait-what moment, the real tipping point, is people like you, people like me, people like anybody that's a part of the wait-what moment.
Mm-hmm.
That might be my new T-shirt, the wait-what moment.
Yeah. Middleman Entertainment. Great minds think alike. HipHopProduction.com. SA2 in the building. What y'all think? I want the prison to stay stupid. Y'all need to really listen when I'm spitting. Really listen when I'm spitting. Ain't nobody bringing it like this.
Is this disguise?
Listen. What would you do, huh? If you knew that in World War II, banks on American soil funded Hitler's fight against Jews? What? It's true, not only did they fund him, they were for him.
Yeah.
Believe the communistic ideas to be supported. Jew war brings opportunity for organizations like the United Nations.
to be placed in command. But even the UN is a front for the Council of Foreign Relations. European Masons hold the power at hand. Or do they? No, Americans are involved. Hillary's the current member of the CFR, pushing us farther from God and closer to socialism, communism, Satanism, Marxism, any ism. It's serious and you think, you think it ain't, but America's debt was planned by the Federal Reserve Bank of Snake invaded Eden in the form of democracy, and this is my way of getting even with the demons.
Man, go Google the Rothschilds, the Bilderbergers, the Rockefellers. Man, do your research on Henry T. Ford. It ain't over, man. The list goes on. Tycoons like J.P. Morgan above the law. So who rules off? No importance. A new world order. One world currency is the plan. Understand who profited from the war in Afghanistan. And you can't begin to see. The shepherd of the flock is actually the wolf among the sheep. Gangbangers hustling on corners to make ends meet are nowhere near as dangerous than the broker on Wall Street. It's deep, the government been tapping our phones. If you gang affiliated, they could raid your homes. If that's the case, why they leaving the White House alone? With three generations of pussies been stolen bones. When we do it, they label it as organized crime. When they do it, they use a terrorist to justify the rules and regulations. Don't apply to Freemasons. And I'm here to put a face to the devil that we facing.
Man, people get killed for putting stuff like this out in the streets, man. But they're out there. It's there. I'ma tell y'all what. Y'all go to the library and ask for a book called Hope of the Wicked. And it's gonna open your eyes, man.
You know how they starve over population. War. Military recruiters are really trapdoors. The floors give way like the levees in Katrina. Where FEMA paid major corporations to clean up. People you couldn't dream of. Wickedness you couldn't fathom. If I had to sit down with Bush, it's what I ask him. Weapons of mass destruction. Saddam didn't have them. So why are we over there while Kim's in Korea laughing? It's happening right under our nose. They desensitize us to shows like Big Brother while invading our home. You know, longer alone. A camera on every corner. Al-Qaeda was an excuse. The cell phone recorder. He's shutting down the border. They just testing the water. And it's nice and warm. Ready for globalist order. So stop worrying about a Democrat. Or worrying about Republicans. Worry about the CFR, the world's secret government is here.